we need to establish some kind of rhythm, okay, which is the most important for getting what mathematical thinking is about. So we're not going to give theorems or to give formalism, but I would like to train you somehow in thinking mathematically and how this can be very relevant for architects. And what's the relation of this with philosophical questions? So where I start is a kind of pictorial thing. I make a triangle, and we will call this triangle the static tripod. Okay, I write it. I will explain what is this, but this somehow encapsulates the concept. So, everybody knows what a tripod is? You know, it has three legs. Okay, so you can think of it as a kind of a three-legged thing. So, if you want to represent it geometrically, the first thing you do is to make a triangle. Okay. But somebody has to be very careful what this triangle is about. So, we do not want to see this triangle in space, but we want to see a triangle in time. Okay, that's the first level of abstraction that we try to make. And this goes with this word here, static, which static doesn't have to be with something which does not move. Static means something which has some kind of stability. Okay, so this idea of, we will analyze this notion of stasis. Okay, it comes from there. But it has to do with stability and invariance, which are very important. Okay, I would say the cornerstone of mathematical thinking is to find some type of invariances. Okay. And if you think what remains invariant through a culture or through a civilization, which can have a life extent of even 1,000 years, and if I ask you to name something, what would you say? Do you have any? Feel free, you know, there are no correct, wrong answers. We do not play a game of being correct. So we try to think, and I ask you to think of something which can be invariant in time, not in space, but in time. Okay, I ask you because.
When you're referring to invariant, what essentially are you referring to?
But that's the whole point. I'm not referring to something. I don't expect you to say something. You know, I'm trying to make a way of thinking at the very first, even premature level, of what invariance is about. Okay, because to have something stable in time, you need something to be invariant, although everything around it can vary. You know, you can have a variation, but some kind of relations, okay, if I can help, they can remain stable in time. So can you think of something? Sorry?
An atom, like a molecule?
A molecule? How do you think of a molecule?
Like the water, water.
It's different to talk about the water and the molecule.
I think
of
like H2O, like
the I can see the point. So if you take the water, so you take two molecules of hydrogen and one of oxygen. And the invariance in this case is in the relation of these things. Okay? So it's not a thing in itself, but it's some relation which is invariant. Okay? And this one I want to point out. But what about myths? Have you thought of this? What children, in the course of time, you know, they learn myths which can be rooted very much in the past. What else? Which is the most characteristic thing of mathematical thinking? To establish, sorry?
Numbers?
Yes, numbers. So I put it down. But again, they are numbers by themselves or the relations between numbers. Okay? This is why I make all, because we have a kind of, we think in terms of objects, but we do not think in terms of relations. Okay? And if you want to get into mathematical thinking, you have to make a twist in your way of thinking. Okay? So we do not think about objects, but we think about the relations which potentially can make some objects which will have invariances. Okay? Because having only the numbers by themselves, it's like you have an alphabet, but you do not have a language, right? Languages, are they invariant? So and so, okay? But there are some elements, structural elements. Here it comes the notion of structure, which remains invariant in the course of time, although the language itself, you know, can change.
So one example is the cases. So now we usually, in German, we have accusative, dative, genitive, and so on. It's, I think, 5. But there are languages which have up to 20 different cases. Or Latin has vocative and I don't remember, some other cases, which we don't have anymore. So the idea of there being cases in grammar is what we could call invariance. But the variation is that in the different languages, it can be a different set. And it can also be different kinds of cases.
Yes, exactly.
And the other example, which for me is very striking, is the natural constants. Okay. So the speed of light, for example. So we cannot, or the amount of energy in the universe. We cannot say how much it is, because how much it is depends on our means of measurement, so on the ratio, on the ways that we articulate it. But there is something that is, invariance is not the same like a constant. This for me was very important, because a constant means we give a value to it. A constant means it's always one mu or whatever it is. So you give a number and a unit, so you already measure it and you say it doesn't change. But an invariance is more like something finite of which we don't precisely know how it is finite.
So even the constants, they have some meaning in the context of physical theory. For example, the speed of light in the context of electromagnetic theory. Okay. So there are some relations which make it invariant. Okay. It doesn't mean that it has a numerical value which remains constant. This is quite trivial to say. The thing is structurally how it relates with the whole environment it refers to. Okay. So this idea of invariance is very crucial and very critical, and we will, of course, do many examples. But I just want you to get started to roll on this kind of path. And I will say another thing, which is the most characteristics, theorems. You know about for the Pythagorean theorem, right? Everybody knows the Pythagorean theorem? Somebody who hasn't heard about the Pythagorean theorem? Okay, good. So you have two sides, right? And you have this relation here. Is this an invariant? When the Pythagorean theorem was formulated, more than 2,000 years before, right? We still use it, okay? That's our basic tool to define the notion of a distance, for example. So this, since it has become a theorem, okay, in the context of a mathematical theory, which is the theory of geometry, this expresses an invariant relation between the sides of a orthogonal triangle and the diagonal. Okay? But you see that this invariant refers to a relation between the sides and the diagonal of a triangle. Okay? So you do not see it as an object, but you see the relation that is expressed through this proposition. Right? Okay, I will talk more about this. But I would like to ask you, has there been any time in your life that you got excited by a mathematical idea or a theorem? Something that you liked? Can somebody say something? Please. Yes, yes. So the difference between the geometries, basically, right?
Yeah.
The Euclidean geometry, the spherical geometry, and the hyperbolic.
Yeah.
Yes, this is typical. You are an architect, right? Yeah, I expect this. So this was the first thing I expected. It is good, actually. Something else, some other kind of, because now I want to enter into this notion of abstraction. What is abstraction? Okay, because the mathematical thinking is based on invariants, but the invariance has meaning in the context of abstraction. So we want to see what abstraction is. Okay, that's why I'm asking you if somebody else would like to say something that...
The imaginary numbers.
The imaginary numbers, yes. That's a very good example. And but it's because of the name or because
when
we will talk a lot about
it. I was very excited, but now I
forgot everything. Okay, yes. Okay, we will remind everything, and it will be one of the cornerstones, actually, the imaginary numbers. Yes, but do you see the invariance in this context? Yes? Just speak by yourself, and then we can... Yes? Although they are imaginary, right?
Yeah.
Yes, yes. Actually, this has... let's go to this triangle. So let's... the triangle has some vertices. So let's try to figure out some vertices which can make a triangle, which will give us the context of what we're speaking about. Okay? So I will put here the mathematics, okay, which is the core of this course. Here I will put architectonics. Look, that architectonics is more general than architecture. Okay, we will see in what sense architectonics is more general. Okay, and here I have philosophy, which includes the different conceptual or philosophical problems which are related with, and how they are related, both with mathematics and architectonics. So the idea is that somehow we try to establish, so don't take that the mathematics is above the other two, okay? The purpose is not this. So you can rotate the triangle and you can put the architectonics on the top. The whole thing of the tripod is that if you choose any two of them, the third one will give bridges connecting the other two. Okay? So this is how we start working and how we base our abstraction. So the idea is, if you choose, for example, a philosophical problem, we will talk about what the problem is. Okay? That's also not easy thing, how we define a problem. So let's say you're in a level, think in terms of levels. You know, as a first approach. So you have something on the level of philosophy. So it's a general philosophical problem, like the relation between part and whole, for example.
Okay.
Or the relation between real and imaginary. Then You can go, for example, in another level of architectonics and see the same question or the same type of problem, how it can be expressed on the architectonic level. Okay? In order to do this, you need some kind of bridges, and the bridges will be given by the third element here, okay, which is the mathematics. But you can, okay, this is totally symmetric. So you can choose as levels philosophy and mathematics, and you can use architectonic bridges, okay, between these things. So this is totally symmetric. So imagine it as rotating. Okay, you can imagine a thing here which is called the origin. Now, what is the origin is also quite important, because the idea is that if you use reason, because we want to use reason, okay, to make the relation between the different levels. So in any case that you want to give reason, okay, reason means that you want to make a proof, or you want to make a logical argument, or you want to build something, okay, or you want to give some order in architectonics, you need to use reason. Reason means you need to be able to make a chain, okay, of thoughts or constructions which can be connected to each other and will lead you to some type of conclusion. Okay? Now, a precondition for having reason is to have an origin. Okay? So you need to have a kind of origin or point of view. The origin you do not know, usually. Because if you knew the origin, then the problem would not be a problem. So always, the origin is in question. But you cannot access the origin of a problem directly. You need an indirect way, and that's why you open up different spaces of thought, okay? Mathematics, architectonics, philosophy, art, mechanics. You open up the whole thing, and then you try to see how the different levels that you opened up, they connect to each other. So what are the bridges between them? Okay?
So maybe, because in architecture, the origin is in PQ, not arche.
Yeah, arche, yeah, arche. Yeah.
But there is no architecture without a relation to origin. And the beauty of this structure is that to say the origin, so whenever you try to get a clear conception of it, it means you reduce, for example, you begin to say, but in architecture, origin means this, whether it is the urbute or whatever you want to put in this place. And it's a problem. Philosophy tries to do the same. No? So they will say in the beginning there are either atoms or a void. So you have two schools, they will never be able to reason together because they're contradictory. But that's because they exclude this and this from their reasoning. Yeah? Or in mathematics, so when you sometimes hear that with Descartes we have finally a notion of a space which is coordinated in one point of origin, it wants to say we can keep mathematics and exclude this and this. So it's always when the problematic of the origin is always if a particular perspective lays claim on it in a way that then needs no translation anymore or no negotiation. So the affirmation of origin that we're proposing is very crucially relating on this triadic structure. And of the tripod, my image was always a chair with three legs. Because in a chair, on the one hand, you have a kind of an elevation, and it's clear that knowledge, so abstraction, increases what you are capable of. So if you can think abstractly, you can act more powerfully. So that's something that we cannot escape. Yeah. That's also part of why we are engaging with this mathematical thinking, because our technologies, which we have in our pockets for every ordinary action, is an enormous power. And it's dangerous for societies. So we need to actively relate to this power. And that means we need to relate to technology as something that doesn't replace. This was always that's the story. If you have a tool for it, then everybody can do it. And it's independent whether somebody has learned how to reason it properly. And this on one hand is true, but on the other hand, we need to start to reason it from another level, in another context. And the picture of the chair, I think, puts this quite nicely, because every chair that has three legs is not very stable. So you can sit there, but it's not really being addressed, but rather you need to continuously balance. And that's part of the way of engaging with this kind of thinking that lies behind the approach that we propose.
Yeah, so here is this notion of archi, okay? This is the original Greek name. This is what I mean by origin. Architecture is based on this, but not only architecture. It's this root R, which is the important, because the notion of this etymological thing, but it has some significance. So if you start mathematics with a notion of numbers and you try to build a cosmos out of numbers, the name of number is arithmos. And you see it has the same root R in front. And in philosophy, you know, you have something which is called harmonia, okay, harmonics, okay, which has also the same root. Now, what this root means, that's the important thing, and this gives us a key to access the tripod, and why this idea of a tripod was, I mean, historically was a kind of a symbol in Delphi. Okay, I don't know if you have been in the museum in Delphi. Maybe not. But it was a symbol of a tripod, okay? It was not a triangle. I will go there, why it had a different form. But in the center was something which was called omphalos. Omphalos means a kind of sender, okay? Which you do not have a direct access. So you need to open up spaces, so you need to have levels or different legs. And through this, to find some kind of stability by starting circumnavigating around this type of tripod. Okay, that was the original concept. And why now we find it currently very, very relevant to the way science and not only science, but philosophy and information theory and I would say architectonics as well. Because you go with the tripod, you go out of dualisms. Okay, you have this idea of, you know what the dualism is? Okay, which is, dualism means that you have two things, okay, like mind and matter, okay? And you make a philosophy which is called dualistic philosophy. This comes now, originates from logic. When you try to make, the first logic was made by Aristotle, and trying to find quite rigid forms for expressing a logical argument. Now the idea is that everything has a kind of negation, okay? So a thing and its negation make up a dualistic pair. But the loss to operate now with this logic includes two things. The one is called the law of excluded middle. Okay. Have you heard about this type of thing? Have you heard about the excluded middle?
No?
You didn't have any course in excluded middle is that you have, let's say, A, or, is the or, the negation of A. Okay? That's the law of excluded middle. Okay, you see what is the dualistic picture here? So you have something and its negation. And it can be either A or the negation of A. This means that any kind of third which is in between them is excluded. Okay? That's the law of logic. And the symmetric of this is called the law of no contradiction. So you say that what it means, that if I take a thing and I take the intersection of this thing with a negation of this thing, then the intersection is empty. Okay, this is the empty symbol. Okay. So again, I have either A or the negation of A. Okay. So these are the two basic laws of Aristotelian logic, which was formulated in what we call now Boolean logic, although Boole made the whole algebra. It's not about, but that's the name. And this now is very useful for syllogism, so expressing propositions and making logical arguments. But when when you have things which are rigid, or they can be distinguished a priori. So it's like I have a chair, okay, and this is a chair. Okay? But
a little bit of a chair.
Yeah, it cannot
that's
be.
What chair.
Yes, but if I want to describe water, that you mentioned before, and I try to apply this logic here, you get nowhere. The same is now with quantum physics, okay, where when you think about elementary particles, for example, the notion of a particle is not a kind of a billiard ball, right, that you can take in your hand and you can distinguish. So when you think of an electron, what an electron is not something that you can see, right? So you cannot distinguish it. So it's something, you see what's called the spectrum out of this. So in these cases, things which are not distinguished sharply, they do not obey these laws. And in this case, you need a third thing in order to gain some stability. So you need to get from dualisms, okay, into tripods. Because only with tripods, then you can be able to form some kind of stable things, stabilizing things around. Yes?
Maybe at this point it's important to make the distinction between what is since Hegel called dialectic. Now you've probably heard of thesis, antithesis, synthesis. So there you would also produce a third, but the third is the start of a duality on a new level. So the dialectic goes in spiral form. It has one center, a contradictory one, and the transcendence of it, which makes a new point, which will produce a new negation, which will again need to be transcended and makes a next one. So you always have the law of the excluded middle or the law of non-contradiction, and then you have, through history, the transcendence of it to a next stage. This is dialectic. It's also including three, but it's a different model than what we are interested in with the tripod. The tripod is in time in a different way than dialectics is in history. Have you heard of, dialectic is true, no? So thesis, antithesis, synthesis. But the term of the medium is also just as an association space. It is coming precisely from the inadequacy of the two logical theorems. So the medium means everything that actually pertains to this middle, which logic cannot address. So the medium is the third domain where you can deal with messiness. So where things are not crystal clear, where they're not logically rigid, but where they are always mixed up, more like chemistry or cooking.
Yeah, so what you can keep in your mind, because you need some kind of pointers, is that this sharp laws of logic do not apply, for example, in liquids or in fluids or in everything that is not directly distinguishable. For example, things that exist in other scale, like microscopic particles, okay, which are wrongly called particles, but that's a kind of tradition coming from classical way of thinking. They do not have a direct access, so you cannot think of it. Nobody has seen directly an electron or a proton or something. So you need a third third domain, okay, which you will give you ways to start traveling between something and the negation of something in logical terms. Okay? So this means that if you have A, whatever this A is, and the negation of A, it's possible to have a non-empty intersection, okay, which from the perspective of classical logic, it looks like a contradiction, but this is unavoidable, okay, because you do not have a direct access. There is a kind of obstacle. Okay? So what do you do in these cases? Okay, in all these cases, you have to go out of dualism. Okay? In philosophy, we have this distinction between mind and matter, for example. Okay? Or you have in computer science the distinction between hardware and software. Have you thought of this? That this is also a dualism. Now the distinction between what is hardware and what is software with the clouds and all this, you see clouds, okay? It's this type of things I'm talking about. A cloud, it's not something which is rigid. Okay? It doesn't have a rigid form to say this is a cloud or up there. So in these cases, you need a third level or element or entity, whatever it is, which will be able to form some stability. Okay. So now what this is interesting is because somehow now we're immersed very much in thinking in terms of space. Okay, everything is in terms of visualizing and in terms of seeing. Okay, so everything is very much dominated by a space view of things. Even when you use your mobile phones, okay, you fill up your time by seeing images or reading texts. Okay? So this is an activity which has a spatial origin. So subconsciously, our culture and our society is transforming everything into space. Okay. The thing is now that this as a way of thinking is related very much, so it makes a bridge with a way of thinking which was prominent more than 2,000 years ago. And that's very interesting because when we want to talk about thinking, so let's say about this idea of historical time, where you imagine a kind of line, okay, and then which you put different events, okay, that's the usual thing, okay, and you move. Here there is a first type of contradiction, okay, because the line by itself is a continuum. And what is a continuum? A continuum means that you cannot distinguish parts of a continuum. You need to have boundaries, for example. But we use the continuum and we index the continuum by putting discrete events. For example, when you learn history at school, okay, you have this notion of a linear time, and then you learn about important events, about the constitutions, about battles, about all these type of things, right? Now, this is not what I call thinking. Okay, it's a kind of description. But it's a description which is based on a deep contradiction. Why? Because you have a continuum where you cannot see parts, and you discretize it by events. So you have the impression, somehow, that time is flowing linearly, okay, in a particular direction, from the past to the future. Okay? This is how we're immersed into thinking about time, okay, in terms of space. But I ask you now the following. So let's say we are here, okay, and we have artificial intelligence, we have information theory, we have quantum physics, okay? We have new notions in architectonics, okay? You see the whole logic of producing architectural elements, how it has changed from the past forms. And you go out of this kind of rigid things involving something and the negation of something. And what you see is that you need always a third element which will negotiate between two things which look to be negating each other. So it's like trying to walk on a lake. Okay? And you need to find some kind of stability. Okay, so we move from the time of rigid forms, okay, as we knew them, to type of informational forms. Okay? So information is the basic thing now. Now, the issue is how to make sense of information, because what we know is to interpret information in terms of space. But if we do this, then we have, for example, this type of pictures when you learn history, when you have a one-dimensional continuum, okay, and you index it with discrete points, which is wrong. Okay. So what can we do? And why this is not correct? Because what we see, let's say we are now, and we go 2,000 years before, and we see that we can make a kind of bridge, okay, between different things. And this doesn't refer only to the present, but if you look very carefully into the history of philosophy, architectonics, you see kind of, instead of a linear development of things, you see a kind of unfolding. So we want to be able to qualify this unfolding, which means that there are things here, although they are very distant in time, okay, but they resonate. Okay, this can be like this. So this is what I call bridges. Okay. Of course, this is very difficult to visualize. Okay, because not like you tend to think of it in terms of space. And if you think of it in terms of space, then you end up with contradictions. Okay, so you need the effort, okay, to enter into the domain of time and to see what are temporal concepts, okay, which pertain to this kind of bridges I'm talking about. So you can make bridges between things which are very distant, okay, in time, and you can see events which happened 2,000 years ago and become extremely prominent now. So this means that distance, in terms of space, is an irrelevant thing in the mathematical sense, okay? Or they are very far, okay, in time, in terms of distance. They can resonate and they can synchronize, okay? And this is what information is about. So information is not about a notion of geometric space, but it's about a notion, I would call it a kind of harmonic. Don't call it space, because it has to do with time, but the whole idea is about events which look very, very distant. They can resonate, and they completely overturn the way we think about history, about, for example, the evolution of science, the evolution of architectonics, philosophy, and all these things. And now we're exactly at this age where this way of thinking becomes very prominent. So we have been trapped in dualisms, not only in philosophy, but in mathematics, for many, many years. Not years only, but centuries, I would say. And now we're emerging out of it, and we try to find stabilities of this form. So the idea is now to try to start investigating what is a bridge. Not in space, but in time. Okay. I don't know if you, yes, please.
Conscious of gender problems, or gender topics. But it's the same thing. So one of the most prominent theorisms is male and female. And the entire interest now in queer cultures and in cultural determination of gender as opposed to sex, so it's looking for the same kind of transition to a media level, like you are talking about in mathematics. And what is underlying our interest in these abstract things are, of course, the very social, the very concrete, the very practical topics which we encounter in all the scales. No? In recycling, we have the same problems. So we cannot, it's not a question of either or, it's always how can it coexist, the values of preserving things, for example, or of keeping them in a good temperament. So the underlying idea with this very abstract mathematical thinking is that regarding to almost every field in a particular time, there is an invariant structure behind which makes certain problems problematic in a particular time. And it's always related to the form of technology, the form of mathematics, and derivative to that, the forms of how we make sense of cultural institutions, of economical forms, and so on. Yeah. And feminism is coming out of metaphysics. This is also, so I'm completely disinvested with gender studies now because it almost completely breaks with this legacy. But the really interesting part of it is how to think of through time, not generations. Generativity through time. Like the omphalos that you have there, it also means the belly button. So it means where there is a cut from one generation to the next. It's a continuity and a cut.
Yes, yes, exactly. This is underrated. Omphalos is exactly the belly button, and this comes with a umbilical cord. Okay, there's a cord there, which is this type of bridge that I'm talking about. And the imaginary numbers you can see as a kind of umbilical cord. Okay, which gives an access to a bigger domain of numbers. But we will go there. Okay, so the objective is now to try to make sense of why we need this type of bridges, which I call bridges in time, but this goes out of the notion of a linear time of events. Okay. And this notion of an abstraction, okay, what we mean by trying to find invariants through abstraction. But before going there, just to close this very small parenthesis on logic, because still what we say, okay, needs to make chains of reason, I would like to ask you, what is the opposite of the sentence, every day is raining? So you say, right. Okay. Every day is raining. Okay. So the opposite, I mean the negation. So you try to look what you negate. The negation goes here for the sun, or it goes here. Where?
Because I can say
What is the opposite? Okay, let's try to see it. Okay, slowly. So if you take the every day, what's the negation of every day?
But there is every end day.
Every?
But there are two words, so I can.
Yes.
Every end day.
Yes. Yes.
So I have two. Yes, because two. Okay. Oh, you're right. Then you can say no day, or you can say every night.
Yeah. Or you can say no night.
Or you can say
so
no night.
Two, then, yeah.
You see that? Logic is not worrying like this. You know, this is a trivial sentence. Okay? Okay, everybody's using it. We need to find the negation. And it's not easy. Okay? So most of the people will put, actually we can vote. Okay? Or we'll put the negation here. Of the raining, right? So what would you say that the negation is that every day is sunny? Is there something between? Exactly, that's the point of this very, very, because it gives a very characteristic example of what I'm talking about. Okay? That you can make all these very nice laws, and then you have a very simple sentence. There are many other examples where, you know, you have to think how you will formulate it. So any other would like to say something as a kind of negation of this? I take this with the sun.
It's not raining every day.
So you still put the raining, the thing is.
Yeah.
Right? You agree? And what if I say that there exists one day which is not raining? Because you have to think of two parts, right? And that's a very common mistake. So it's the everyday, and there is also the rain. And you have to think of a negation, okay, which is distributed between these things. So, when we say every, okay, the way we negate is that we say there exists at least one. Right? Okay, and there is a symbol for this. So, for this you use this symbol. And for there exists at least one, you use this symbol. Okay? Okay, you do not have to care about the symbols, but every proposition which has the every, okay, it's negated by there exists at least one. There can be two, there can be three, whatever. Okay. So you see a kind of negation which is not trivial. Okay. Although the sentence itself, you use it, you know, very, very often. And so, how to express, when I talk about reason, it's about respecting these rules, okay? So if you want to express an argument mathematically, okay, not only mathematically, of course, philosophically also, and I would say in architectonics, okay, because architectonics has to do with order, you need to be able to play between something and the opposite or the negation of it. So the negation is not that you put the not only in front of something, okay? So you need a kind of to distribute between these parts. Okay, this is an example. We have, yeah.
The philosophy comes in because if you think there exists at least one day, mm-hmm. The philosophical assumption is that all the days that will ever have happened, because you're talking about existence, are already there before they come. So you have a certain conception of time implied, which is larger than the continuity that you acquire in logic. And out of ideas like this, you have in philosophy and in myths, you begin to have different personalizations of time. So you have, for example, Io, which is a kind of an eternity which never exhaustively realizes itself. Or then you have Chronos, which is one day after the other, like in chronology. And you have other notions. They all characterize time in a different way. And all of them are reasonable according to a particular constellation of existential and universal predicate logic. That's how, even in logic, you cannot get rid of the metaphysical questions. But if you are reasoning in metaphysical questions, you need logic. So the two are not excluding, but they're never coinciding.
Yes. So since we talk about these different personifications of time, I will just say an example that for example, in ancient Greek philosophy, there were three conceptions. The one was chronos, okay, which is, means the chronological passage of events.
Kairos.
Yes, there is kairos, keros in Greek. Okay.
And this you saw in the morning in rhetoric, was and a keynote, seizing a moment.
Yes.
This is kairos.
This is exactly prominent in rhetorics. And aeon. Okay, which means how you think about large periods of time, okay? One century, or about millennia and all these type of things. Now, this is very crucial, the keros. Why? Because it gives you the kind of what's called situational context. So the context, that's a situation appears, but also it relates with a particular instant that something happens. It's the instant of resonance, I would call it mathematically. Okay? So there is a context, and there is a particular instance where something emerges. Okay? And this also is very relevant if you think in terms of meteorology, when you talk about the climate, for example. Because now we make all this kind of, you know, statistical simulations. But the whole idea, in order to be able to say something reasonable about the climate, is to find situational contexts and prominent instances, you know, instances where something emerges, like a thunder. Okay, this is the whole thing. This all pertains to this notion. And it doesn't have to do anything with this, the chronological sequence of events. But you have you cannot, okay, write it chronos here. Okay. So the three. You see, again, they form a triangle, okay, a tripod. Okay. This is also something important. You have to think in terms of stabilities, which are formed by at least three different conceptions of the thing, of the same thing. So then you are out of contradictory dualisms. Okay. Okay. Now, what I promised you is to try to make sense of what are these bridges in time. And the best way to make a kind of introduction about this today is to think of the following, the simplest example. That is this notion of an obstacle. Okay. I write it with capitals. What is an obstacle? Example. Let's say you walk on a straight line, okay? And there is a hole in front of you, okay? This is an obstacle to your walking. What are you going to do? Okay, it seems trivial. But if you try to, you start abstracting from these trivial things, this is what we do, okay? This mathematical thing is based on this. Okay? So it's very simple, but becomes non-trivial because of abstraction. But you always start from this type of things. So I ask you, let's paint it. Okay, so you have a line. You move on the line. And let's say one point of this line is missing. Okay, this is an obstacle. What are you going to do? Go around. Yes, exactly. This is what you start doing. So you can go like this, or you can go like this. So this is the obstacle. So you see that the natural motion, okay, that you do when there is an obstacle is you start circulating. Okay, so you have to go out of the linear domain. Okay. So this is the idea of circulation. And as soon as what this means, let's try to abstract it. This means that as soon as there is something which can count as an obstacle, okay, we're immediately out of this picture, okay, of time with a linear order of events. Okay, I hope you see it. The idea is the following, that if you think in terms of, let's take history, okay, and you look only at the events, what you do is you hide the obstacles. Okay. So in this way, you have a very linear way of viewing things, but it's only descriptive. So you say that this thing happened there, this battle happened there, this kingdom appeared there, this empire appeared there. Okay. So you order everything, because this is about ordering. And ordering means you start to make a kind of architectonics. Everything on a line, which you imagine as a kind of smooth flow, okay, the flow of time, or the arrow of time, you know. And then you just put pointers which refers to events. This means that you are like an external observer who looks from above and you try to order things on a linear continuum. This means that you forget completely about the obstacles. Okay? Because from this very simple example, okay, you see that in any case that some obstacle exists, it doesn't have to be a hole, okay, but any type of things which divert, okay, from a linear motion of events requires this type of circulation. For example, okay, you are in the sea and you want to navigate. What are the obstacles? There are many types of obstacles, right? Say some. No, you're in the sea. Okay, you have a boat. And you try to... Yes, for example. But for example, if I talk about an island, the island is an obstacle to a linear motion of a boat. Right? Of course, you have to go around. Okay. So from this very, very simple examples, you see that whenever there appears a kind of obstacle, which is topological or whatever, we will encounter many obstacles, you have to start circulating. Okay, so you go to a non-linear motion, Okay, so you go out of the linear continuum. This means that if you start thinking in terms of lines, in terms of linear continua, okay, what you forget all the obstacles. So you have a God's eye of view, you see only events, and the price you pay is that this is a totally disconnected thing. So you have a discrete sequence of events without any connectivities. The idea here of starting circulating around is to establish a connectivity, which is a topological notion, between this part and this part. Okay? Now I'll ask you, in a single line, if I remove this point so it becomes an obstacle, what is the distance between this and this? So from one side to the other, what would you say? Depends on what? So from here to here. If I ask you from here to here, you can say, okay, that's trivial. Tak? Okay. But what is the distance from here to here? What is this? Yes, it's a temporal thing, but the distance itself is infinite. So it's not a matter of distance. Okay? So you go beyond the level of geometry. Okay, this is a very simple example of what topology is about which we will talk. But everything is based on these very, very simple conceptions in the beginning. And then you try to build on making abstraction. But as soon as you realize that if you have a line, on the line itself, you can calculate the distance between any two points. But if you remove a single point, then the distance between the two parts becomes infinite. So this means that distance doesn't play any role. So this circulation, okay, it's of a topological nature. It's not of a geometric nature. Okay, now let's try to see. Okay, I have to. Do you see everybody if I run in the middle or? Because they are very near to here. So let's say that you take what's called the historical line of events, which can, for example, show the development of thinking in architecture, okay, or whatever you like. So if you see things in terms of chronology, okay, events, what you hide, you hide the obstacles. Hiding the obstacles means that you are able to do only description, but you cannot think. Okay? It's different, it's difficult, different to describe and to think. In order to start thinking in every discipline, you have to start looking for the obstacles. Because only in the case that there are obstacles, okay, you see change. Otherwise, everything, yes?
So ekphrasis in the rhetoric course.
Yeah, ekphrasis.
As we introduced in the morning, it means to describe something which is not here with a life equality. And the whole art of how to achieve such a life equality in order to create vividness in the description. And then the ekphrasis description, you would be fine as well.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
But description saying this amount of meter, this amount of da-da-da, that's not, yes. That's a different thing.
Yes. So the whole point now to start thinking, to go beyond the descriptive level, is to start to making sense of what is an obstacle. Okay? And how you are able to locate obstacles. The first thing that you need to start locating obstacles, so we follow. So we do not go like this. Okay, this is the description. For thinking, we start to go like this. So we have to invert. And the inversion consists in starting to locating obstacles. What is the first thing that you need to locate an obstacle? I listen to you. What's the first thing that you need to start locating obstacles? You can start. Sorry?
You have to start. You have to have a starting point where you can measure the position of the obstacle. Like your.
This is very. When you walk and there is a hole in front of you, you don't calculate anything. You do not calculate the distance, right, from the hole. Or, I mean, you use your vision, so you use your senses, right? I'm trying to, you know, that things can look very complicated, but usually they're very simple on the base. So the first thing that you have to use is your senses. This means that you have to use your vision, you have to use your ear, and if it's dark, you have to start touching. Okay. So if you see it from this point of view, okay, the whole purpose of the senses is to locate, to make you able to locate obstacles. Okay. Because if everything was smooth and continuous and nice, and there was a smooth flow everywhere, you would not be in need of your senses. Okay. So the idea about the senses now is that it makes you able, okay, to start locating differences and essentially obstacles. Now, what this means? This is not direct, of course. Okay, it's not only the faculty of vision, for example, but it has to be processed informationally, okay, through your brain. So if you combine these two things now, so you make a kind of syllogism, the first necessary condition for locating obstacles is what? What is immediately after the senses? See, now you should be on fire. You should be on fire now. Sorry? Yes, but you need something. You need to have a brain. If you do not have a brain, right? So you need intelligence. Okay, that's the. Okay. You need to have physical intelligence, you know, the intelligence that you have, or artificial intelligence. Okay. So artificial intelligence is a necessary condition for obstacle location. Okay. you have to start twisting a little bit your the way of thinking in space, because now we make the exercise to think in time. Okay? And this twists things from the way we usually are thinking. But it's a good exercise, and it's also a very good fun to make it. And because if I started to ask you, what is intelligence? So I ask you, what is intelligence? What would you say? Physical intelligence, artificial intelligence, or? If you do not, yeah, to solve problems, you know, it would be. But if you do not have this temporal perspective, would you connect intelligence with obstacles? The notion of obstacle is very crucial. An obstacle doesn't mean that there is necessarily, you know, something that you cannot walk through. It means something which is also not directly accessible. So some kind of inaccessibility. When you talk about the universe, for example, the macroscopic world, the megacosm, or when you talk about the microcosm, okay, all these are obstacles. So you need intelligence. Physical, or the extension of the physical intelligence, which comes from melting it with the artificial intelligence. Okay? And this is what information is at the basis, in order to start revealing these obstacles. So you open up this kind of dark regions, if you think of them in visual terms. And for this, you need intelligence. Is it this a necessary condition? Now, I'm saying this because in mathematics, we have two types of conditions. Okay, not only mathematics, in the way of thinking. You have necessary conditions and sufficient conditions. Okay? Necessary condition does not mean that it is sufficient. What it means is that in order to be able to uncover obstacles, we said that intelligence is a necessary condition. But is it sufficient as well? I mean, is it enough to have only intelligence? That's the question. If it is enough, then it's also a sufficient condition. If not, this means that there would be another condition which is combined together with intelligence. Yes, please.
Well, in action, right?
It's
not enough. You have the brain, you have to do action.
What else you need? Action.
Yeah.
What's action?
Walking around. No, okay.
Yes, yes. But
reaction.
Action, reaction, yes, is related with doing something, or with energy, which says all these things, but it's not a necessary condition. Because you can't be static and you can still look in.
So you can just be an observer without interacting?
Yes, or you can interact in another way. It doesn't mean that you need some physical action. You need some type of action,
yeah.
Mental action. But a mental action, what other necessary condition it has beyond intelligence?
Yeah, memory and imagination.
It's memory and imagination, exactly. Yes. So you need these three necessary conditions. And then you have a sufficient tribute. Again, so you have intelligence, you have memory, you have imagination. Now again, why these are necessary conditions for obstacle location? Because if I take any two of them, we will do it in detail next time. The third provides the bridges between the other two. So if you consider intelligence and memory, these do not form a kind of dual pair, but you need a third element, which is given by imagination, which provides you the bridges for these two things to coordinate or to synchronize or to resonate. So these three things give not only give sufficiency. This is what you need to be able to locate obstacles. Which means to start doing mathematics. Questions? I see faces which are asking. This is to be expected. But if you have to say something, say it. Because it's not going to get any better. So we understood the difference between necessary and sufficient conditions. That's also very important. Okay, now let's start to see how, yes, I have to write it, let's write it here, what is that? So now, what we do is we open up this line. We see that this is, I think I gave you convincing arguments, that this line of ordering events is good at the level of description, but it's not about thinking. So you cannot think about anything. It gives you a kind of overview, God's eye view of things. The idea is the following now, that if you have, let's say, two very important events, in order that these events are important, means that in order to move from one to the next, there was some obstacle. Okay? There is no important event in the evolution of thinking without the existence of some obstacle which has been circulated around. Another word for circulation is embracing. Okay? This idea of embracing an obstacle. Okay? The mathematical term is circulation. Okay, so the existence of an obstacle means that this descriptive view that I go from here to here, let's say in a linear, sequential, smooth way, is not correct. Okay, so the existence of an obstacle means that there was some type of circulation around it, okay? And this circulation was effective in order that this obstacle is embraced, and as soon as it is embraced, then you are able, okay, to move forward and to have, to give rise to some kind of event. So this type of thing you can think as a kind of bifurcation, or but the mathematical essence of it is this idea of circulation. Now, how? This idea of circulation fits with this picture. That's the question. So we'll try to do this. We'll make just an introduction today, and next lecture we will go to focus, because this will be our method, okay, to go through the whole of this mathematical thinking we're going to talk about. So the problem is the following, that you have something here, let's say, that's just a way of visualizing, and there is no direct way to go to here. Okay, there is a hole, there's a problem. Okay, you can call it as you like. So what you do? Let's say that this can be called a kind of level, okay, which is not directly accessible, because if it was directly accessible, okay, there would be a kind of immediate or direct solution. So what you have to think of, and what's at the basis of this regulation, is that you have to be able to build a kind of bridge. This bridge with another level. So you need to be able to transpose, okay, the original into another level. So you need to be able to build up a way, let's call it a bridge, okay, that transforms now this, let's say, initial given or initial data or initial event, whatever it is, to here. As soon as we will see in detail now how we can do this, but I want you now to get just an overview of the method. As soon as we are able to make this kind of transference, then hopefully, okay, we can choose a level where this obstacle does not appear. This doesn't mean that this is a kind of smooth land that you can just go through. Maybe it involves a level where obstacles of this level have been already resolved in a previous time. Okay? So you are able to move unobstructed on this level. Okay, so you move here. The question is it enough? As you see, you are still on a different level from the appearance of the initial problem, okay, or the initial obstacle, because the obstacle is here. Here is the obstacle. So this is not enough. We have to be able to make an inverse bridge. Okay. This is also a bridge, and you see that it's facing upwards in this, which will be the inverse of this one. Because as soon as we are able to do this, then we have been able to complete circulation. You see that this is a circulation. We just have broken the circulation into levels and bridges. But as soon as you enter this kind of thing, what you do, okay, is that you circulate through another level. Okay, that's the idea. This other level doesn't have the obstacle that you had in your initial level. So as soon as you are able to do this type of thing, okay, then you embrace through the circulation the obstacle that you encountered on the initial level. Now, what this means is that The circulation, what it achieves, it establishes a communication now. It establishes a communication between the level of the obstacle, where the obstacle was located, and another level, which is not affected by this obstacle. So basically, you make these two different levels to do what? To talk. This is talking. And if you try to talk with somebody, okay, which comes from a different way of thinking, probably, and you encounter so next time we'll go in detail, the bridges. So I just thought I want you to give you an overview. A bridge is everything, okay, which is able to establish a connectivity between two different levels. But don't think of a bridge as something in space, so like a geometric bridge. It's useful to think of a bridge in time. So how? So let's try now to see what this means at this level. Okay. So let's take the line of events. And you apply this type of scheme here. Can you see what we get? Okay, let's try to draw it. So we have here events. Again, these are important events. For example, in mathematical thinking, you have events about the conception of geometry or the conception of algebra or, you know, big theorems. Or in architecture, you can think of the big figures in your in architecture, and you can see the difference in styles, right? Or how you think of scales in architecture. You know, these are big, what I call big events. And whenever you encounter this type of thing, there is not a smooth line connecting them. So this means that there is always kind of obstacle in between, which somehow has been embraced. And this gave rise to something which is a phase transition. And why it's called phase transition? Very simply, because if you think in this simple model again, and you circulate. What you change here, what is the variable which is changing? If I move in a circle,
time?
What type of time?
Vector is changing.
Which vector? this vector. You see how different is this from this? Because if I'm on a line, I go like this. Right? If I'm in a circle, I go like this. So it's a rotation. So what is the variable which is changing? What is changing? The angle. And the direction is, yes, the direction, you can say it's also correct, the direction. But eventually, the whole point is to come back here. So the average of all these directions cancels out. So, but what is really changing is the angle, or it's called the phase. Okay? So if you manage to changing the phase, eventually, okay, when you have embraced the obstacle, what has happened? Has happened a phase transition now. Right? But why is it a transition? Because if you see it here, it's like when you start circulating, it's like you have come back. Let's say you start to circulate here, okay? So I go around. It's like I have come back where I started, right? But is this the case? You have to think. Okay, we'll do it in detail, how you combine this with this. Okay? Because it's not only that you circulate on a circle, because if you just circulate it, you would have a circle. And if you move in a circle, okay, I move in a circle, I come back where I started. But if simultaneously I move on a line, okay, I have a combination of two things. And this is the crucial thing, okay, to get you to a different level, because we talked about levels here. So you have an initial level, you have bridges. It seems that you go back, but in order to embrace the obstacle, you're not at the same level where you started, okay? You travel through something else. So you have a motion which is called a spiral. The beginning of a spiral, if you want to see it geometrically. We will do this in detail. I just want you to start getting keywords and to start relating things. Okay. So let's try to see how it works here. So we said that from here to here, it's impossible. If these events were really important, okay, this means that there was not a smooth connection between them. So there was some obstacle, and there was some kind of circulation around. So you start, okay, to make this type of things. Now, be careful that I initially painted only one different level. But maybe one only level is not enough. Okay? Maybe it's necessary, but it's not sufficient. Okay, you see how the same things appear. So maybe you need more levels. Nobody forbids you, okay, of going. What you do here, you go deeper. So you build some depth into history. Okay? This is the direction of depth. And the same thing now would apply for this type of thing here. Right? So what you built like this is something which looks like a network. Do you see this network? Now there are two important things here in this network picture. Because this includes, in every stage, a kind of circulation. Okay. Presenting the events only, you hide completely these type of things. So basically, you have no idea what really happened or what were the obstacles. Locating by intelligence, memory, and imagination, starting unveiling, this unveiling, okay, obstacles, you end up with this type of network. Okay, that's the first word. What's a network? But this is not a network in space, but it's a network in time. This means that if there are connections, I can make this type of event to resonate with this. Why? Because there are all the paths in time, okay, to go from here to here. So this means that I built connectivities there. So there are paths through which I can navigate, like I navigate when I sail in the sea. It's the same thing. I can navigate in history. And this is very important to get what thinking is about. So thinking, in particular mathematical thinking, is being able to navigate, okay, by embracing obstacles. We will see, okay, next time in detail what this thing means, but I want you to start visualizing this thing. So think, let's say that going from here to here, we said that requires a kind of phase transition in this kind of thing that I described. Now take everything which happened in the history of a subject. And use this net and try to apply it to the totality of events which happened. It's like you are a fisherman of the old times and you have a big net. The question is, what would go through here, through the holes of this net, which is what is called a sieve in time? Have you heard this expression, sieve? It's like a filter. I want you to be able, okay, to see this, okay, as a kind of net. So the net is based on being able to weave. Okay, it's weaving, which starts to make this net functional. Okay? And weaving now is where architectonics starts. You cannot have architectonics without weaving. It's the old history of Daedalus. Okay? I don't know if you are familiar. You know, Daedalus is considered to be the first architect. And he was making this kind of artifacts called the Xoana. But this now, they were bound together in a form of chains or cords in a way that they were giving a kind of weaving net, okay, through which, as a kind of miniature, they will try to think, okay, about architectonics, basically. That's the beginning of the architectonics. So it's based on being able to make this type of sieves. Yeah, the
Xoana. Translate as mobile statues.
The mobile statues, yes.
So they're like statues, but they're more like robots or machines. So
yeah, exactly.
Mobile.
It's a, it
like the Stier, the wound that he then did for the labyrinth.
It was a type of artificial intelligence.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Anybody?
Yes. But the mobile statues, they were not separate. So they were connected with cords or chains. And in this way, they could be animated. Okay? So by pushing cords, they were giving a kind of animated thing. But the structure of this thing is this. Okay? So it's this weaving, okay, through bridges and levels. Okay? That you start to encounter now with the architectonics referring to time. Because the architecture in space comes from thinking about architectonics in time first. Because, of course, in architecture, okay, this idea of weaving is, of course, is prominent, right? To give stability into something. What you do is you try to, but try to think now, if you have a weaving, simplest case, okay, like this, and you want to think of these points of intersection, and you want to think of them as invariants now. From these three necessary conditions for thinking, these points would correspond to what? To intelligence, to memory, or to imagination? What would you say? To all of them. Possibly? But yes, you can consider them, but you need these points, the right, the vertices. Without them, the whole thing would fall apart. Right? So yes, you can think of all of them, but I think that here is where memories, the memory is dominant, okay, as an invariant. It's like knots. Kind of nothing. Yes. So I make now an introduction to what we're going to talk about, but through these pictures, because otherwise you would get scared, possibly. So, the intelligence, we said that is the necessary condition for the obstacle. But the obstacle here is, okay, is how you go from one side to the other, basically. Okay? Because we said that in this is a net which has emerged through embracing obstacles. So it's like, not like a smooth net. Okay? That was the whole point of making this. And the imagination, as I see it, is how you are able to make this inverse bridges. Okay? Because you need the bridges, you need the nodes, and you need the circulations. So you need three again. Okay, a threefold to start making sense of this type of this weaving. Which is the essence of architectonics, this kind of weaving. So you need knots, you need bridges, and you need circulations. Okay, you are not able to think about weaving by placing everything on a line and then discretizing it with points. It's impossible. And this now creates a kind of pocket. You can think of this thing as a kind of pocket, which also has a kind of thermodynamic meaning. Because if you think that, I don't know if you are familiar with this idea of entropy, and I'll close it here, that you have this kind of arrow of time, and things are tending to disorder. So from order, you go to disorder, right? And this is a kind of picture which comes together with the arrow of time. But if you have animation, you have weaving, you have processes which are negentropic. Okay? So these kind of pockets, okay, in this weaving net, they are pockets of negentropy. So in order to have negative entropy, you need to have both memory, okay? You cannot do it without memory, or anamnesis, as it was called in Platonic philosophy. You need to have this type of bridges, okay? So you need to be able to have communication, basically, to be able to talk. So talking is a negentropic activity. And you need to be able to circulate between different levels. If you are only in a single level, there the entropy arrow will collapse you. Okay? And of course, this is now thinking is what's at the basis of negentropic, if you want to see it from this thermodynamics physical perspective. And this is why thinking it's something which is evolving and creates depth. Because as we said, this is a dimension of depth here. I think I stop here, right? There exists at least one day which is not raining.
Wednesday is like today. When you want to substitute, then talk at the show.